during the period of lockdown. And in that pursuit, we have been doing webinars and calling speakers who can give their knowledge and share their insights of law and beyond law, on which they have been expert. And today being our 160th webinar and series, meaning thereby we have been holding daily one webinar from the day we started off. And even we had initially two, but since the at least the virtual courts have started pan India. So we have started one, and that too, we try that it should be after the court hours, and they are all well received. And the happiest part for today is, and we are glad that amongst us, we have Justice N. Kumar, former judge of the Karnataka High Court, who has been also the president of the Karnataka Judicial Academy. His judgments and knowledge of the civil law speaks volume for itself. So much so that being a coordinator on WhatsApp messages, we were always receiving that we should bring Justice N. Kumar on this platform so that he could share his knowledge. And interestingly, we had speakers from Pan India, but from Karnataka Bar, we are happy to share that it is for the first time that we've been able to bring some speaker that gives us a different sense of pride, and a person who has been considered to maintain high standards amongst the judiciary and what he expected from the bar itself. And I will just quote what the then Chief Justice Subhra Kamal Mukherjee said when Justice N. Kumar had superannuated. It said it would be difficult to get judges of Mr. Kumar's caliber to fill the vacuum created in the High Court due to his retirement. But I add one word. The vacuum could have been created in the judiciary, but to share his knowledge, that pursuit is continuing, either it is a virtual platform or a seminar. So the sense of sharing his knowledge during even these testing times and different platforms, Pan India, etc., speaks volume of the knowledge sharing part he believes in, and in the entire motto what we generally have, that caring is sharing. And without taking much time, I will call upon Justice N. Kumar to start sharing his ideas on this topic, which on the first brush looks very simplistic, but it has its own nitty-gritties under law, because they say every statute, every section, once starts having the insights by a lawyer, it has its own rigor molds and the interpretations. And we couldn't have anyone better speaking on the topic on part performance, a part of the Transfer of Property Act. For students of law and a common man or professional or a professor to understand these nitty-gritties from Justice N. Kumar, over to you, sir, and thank you once again for accepting our invite.
Thank you. Good afternoon to all. It's a great pleasure. Thanks to the COVID-19. But for it, we would not have had an occasion to have a seminar like this. What is surprising to me is, during this period, the legal fraternity throughout the country have accepted the challenge and have utilized their time in enhancing the legal knowledge and their capacity. And that gives me a great pleasure to share what I little know about the subject. Coming to the subject, part performance. This is a doctrine which we have imported into our system from Englishmen. This is an English doctrine of part performance, but we could not import it in full. Partially, we have imported this doctrine into the Indian law. When the Transfer of Property Act was enacted in 1882, Section 53A did not find a place in it. Section 53A was inserted in the Act for the first time in 1929. This was not the part of the Indian statute. Now that this doctrine of part performance has become a part of the Indian law, it is necessary for us to to know its implications, the rights which flow from the said provision. And but for this provision, what would have been the position of a person who has entered into an agreement, paid consideration, and the owner, the vendor, or to go back on his promise, what would be his fate? In fact, this provision, more than conferring any right, it furnishes a statutory defense to a person who has no registered title deed, sale deed in his favor, to maintain his position, that is to protect his position, if he can prove a written and a signed contract in his favor. For a proper understanding of this doctrine, and look into section 50, if it had been there after 54, it would have been better than this. Sale is a transfer of ownership in exchange for a price paid or promised, or part paid or part promised. So there could be a sale even without full consideration being paid. But when in the case of immovable property of value of more than 100 rupees, it is evidenced by a registered document. It is the registration of the document which conveys title to the property. Otherwise, title doesn't pass. That is what section 54 says. But more importantly, what we have to see in 54 is the definition of contract of sale, contract for sale. This 53A comes in between this contract for sale and sale. A contract for the sale of immovable property is a contract that the sale of such property shall take place on the terms settled between the parties. What is more important and significant is section declares it does not, that is, contract for sale does not of itself create any interest in or charge on such property. This is the most important aspect of contract of sale. There may be a written contract evidencing an agreement. The entire sale consideration is paid. With all this, in the end of the day, the purchaser gets no right in the property. Absolutely no right in the property. His only right would be to file a suit of specific performance and to the court of law obtain the sale deed. So therefore, taking advantage of this, we find in real life gullible people are misled and money is taken out, several sale agreements come into effect, and an attempt is made to cheat a bona fide purchase. This is one aspect. Another important aspect is, if the people in the legal fraternity do not have a clear notion about this definition, it is my experience in court, with the contract of sale itself, they will be arguing that there is a sale. The entire consideration is paid, written agreement, even if it is registered, it makes no difference in the eye of law. It does not create any interest in or charge on such property. The only right the purchaser gets under the contract of sale is to enforce the contract and obtain a sale deed through the process of law. So it is in this background we have to understand the significance of 53A, which I said imported into law in the year 1929. Even today in England, no written contract is required. But in India, the contract must be in writing and it should be signed by the parties. So in this background, when we look into section 53A, probably we understand it better. So what does section 53A say? That's why it's called as a part performance. It is a statutorily it is provided. In section 54, defining contract for sale says it does not create any right by a statute. And only when a sale deed is registered title bosses. In this background, 53A says, if you satisfy the requirement as in 53A, the purchaser, who has mere contract of sale, gets a right to protect his possession. Possession is 9 points in law. And that possession, once given to him, in part performance of a contract of sale, then he can protect his possession even against the true owner. That's the concept. So 53A says, where any person contracts to transfer for consideration. So the first condition is, it should be a contract for transfer for consideration. Any immovable property, by writing, signed by him, or on his behalf, from which the terms necessary to constitute the transfer can be ascertained with reasonable certainty. So agreement should be clear, it should be in writing, it should be signed by the party, and it should be for a consideration. Once these conditions are satisfied, then what are the rights that the transferee gets? The transferee has, in part performance of the contract, taken possession of the property or any part thereof, or the transferee being already in possession, continues in possession, in part performance of the contract, and has done some act in furtherance of the contract, and the transferee has performed or is willing to perform his part of the contract, then, notwithstanding that, where there is an instrument of transfer, that the transfer has not been completed in the manner prescribed, therefore, by the law for the time being enforced, the transferor or any person claiming under him shall be debarred from enforcing against the transferee, and persons claiming under him any right in respect to the property of which the transferee has taken or continued in possession, other than a right expressly provided by the terms of the contract. So it acts as an estoppel against the true owner to get possession from the purchaser on the ground that the sale deed is not registered. So even though an agreement of sale is there, consideration is paid or agreed to be paid, but in part performance of the contract, either the entire property or a portion of the property, possession is to be taken. And after taking possession, he must be ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. Then section 53A steps in and says, the transferor cannot dispossess the transferee from possession, and transferee's possession is protected by the operation of law. Here, what is interesting is, there's an amendment, recent amendment. The words, then notwithstanding that the contract, though required to be registered, has not been registered, was there earlier. Now that word, the contract, though registered to be registered, required to be registered, has not been registered, is omitted. We'll come to that little later. So today, as the law stands, the Transfer of Property Act assumes importance because of a lot of developmental activities throughout the length and breadth of the country. Therefore, this section 53A has assumed importance. It gives a what is called as a statutory right on account of purpose. As I said, in England, it was only a right in equity, and it could be enforced by a person even without a written contract. But in India, it continues to be an equitable right. But unless there is a written contract, that is most important, unless there is a written contract in India, section 53A is not restricted. So therefore, in India, first a written contract, and then it is a defense to the purchaser. It is on that probably we have to apply our mind and see whether it applies to all circumstances to make it really an effective remedy. So therefore, a right is given to a defendant, purchaser, in the event the plaintiff owner seeks possession of the property. Even though there is no safety, even though there is no registration, he could say you cannot take possession to the real owner. That is the importance of Section 50BA. So therefore, what we must look into in this section is to get the benefit of this particular section, what are the conditions which a purchaser has to fulfill? All the obligations are on the purchaser. Now, the same for non for basing a claim under Section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act is, firstly, there must be a contract to transfer for consideration any immovable property. Without consideration, it has no use. 53A is not attractive. A transfer for consideration any immovable property. Secondly, that contract should be in writing, signed by the transferor or by someone on his behalf. Otherwise, it doesn't bind you. Sometimes there are co-owners. If all the co-owners have not signed it, only few have signed it, this defense is available only to the persons who have signed, and you cannot proceed to service the defense against persons who are not parties to the contract. Then the writing must be clear. There should not be any ambiguity. There must be a clear intention between the parties to convey the property for a consideration. Therefore, the words used in that contract must be such words from which the terms necessary to construe that transfer can be ascertained. And the most important aspect of 53 is the transferee must, in part performance of the contract, that's where you get the word part performance. Part performance of the contract, taken possession of the property or any part thereof. If possession is not taken, 53 is not. It is only when either the possession of the entire property or a portion of the property is taken. Sometimes it so happens, property is given to on lease to a tenant. Tenant is in possession. Now an agreement of sale is entered into during the pendency of the lease. Now, under the agreement of lease, he has already been in possession, put in possession, lawful possession. But subsequently, when an agreement of sale comes into it, to deliver possession, the owner is not in possession. Purchaser is already in possession in the capacity of the lessee. What this section says, it is not necessary that under the agreement itself you have to take possession. If you are not in possession, you must take possession under the agreement. If you are already in possession, you can continue in possession in part performance. The intention of the parties is to be made clear by words, proper words in the agreement. So it is not necessary that if he is already in possession, question of taking possession over again will not arise. There he will continue to be in possession. Only thing is, earlier he was there in the lessee, and after the agreement of sale, he will continue in possession in part performance of the agreement of sale. So therefore, possession is the most important aspect of 53A because it is that possession which will be protected under Section 53A. But before the purchaser can seek protection under 53A, mere taking possession is not sufficient. There is a consideration to be paid. Normally, a part of the consideration is paid. Some conditions are imposed. On fulfillment of the conditions, the balance consideration will be paid, maybe at the time of injury. So when there are mutual obligations to be performed by the parties, and when in part perform the contract, possession is delivered, if the purchaser wants to have the benefit of 53A, he must be always ready and willing to perform this part of the contract. perform his obligations under the contract, he must express so. Only then he would be entitled to protection of the possession which was given to him in part performance of the act. So therefore, this provision, statutory provision, does not create any positive right. It does not create a title. But it could be said, once possession is given, when it complies with all these requirements, he can protect his possession. Therefore, what is called as possessory title. But that possessory title, which he can claim, is only as a defense. Is only as a defense. And the real owner is stopped from claiming possession from the transferee, who is ready and willing to perform his part of the contract after taking possession of the property from him. So therefore, it is an estoppel. It acts as an estoppel against the owner seeking possession. So therefore, there's a lot of what you call discussion, and various high courts have taken various views. And starting from the 1967 Supreme Court, you will find they have said it is only a shield. There is the word shield and not a sword. Therefore, the interesting discussion, which as people of legal fraternity should do, when a statute gives these rights, though the word used is he can protect his possession, it is only when an attempt is made to interfere with his possession. Therefore, consistently the courts have taken it is only a shield and not a sword. Sword means, question is whether he can come to court with that agreement and protect his possession. Of course, majority of the judgments have said it is only a shield and not a sword. But when a person has an agreement of sale in his favor, possession is also delivered, he can file a suit for specific performance. Absolutely, there is no difficulty. So therefore, to say that 53A is only a negative right and not a positive right, and the title is not given, though prima facie correct, the person who has such an agreement can come to court to enforce the contract of sale and is entitled to a decree for specific performance. But the question is, if he doesn't seek the relief for specific performance, then what is the legal position? Take a case where he doesn't file a suit for specific performance, or the suit for specific performance is time barred. Does it mean the statutory right which is conferred on him is lost? Is one thing. Now, I'm in possession. I have paid partial consideration. I'm ready and willing to perform my balance consideration, perform all my acts. Now, the owner, knowing well 53A acts as an estoppel, say takes law to his own hands. He tries to throw me out by force. And if the doctrine is held to be only a shield and not a sword, then how does this section 53A comes to his rescue? At least he must have a right to come to court for an injunction requesting the court to restrain the owner not to dispossess him except in accordance with law. A person who is in possession, lawful possession, a settled possession, or unlawful possession, he cannot be dispossessed under the Indian law. Nobody can take law to their own hands. He has to go to court for ejectment, go to court for recovery of possession, and only in a manner in accordance with law, possession can be taken. The position of a person who is in possession under 53A cannot be worse than that. Here he has been lawfully put into possession. under a written contract of sale for which the owner is a party, consideration is paid, he is ready and willing to perform his remaining part of the contract, and if such a owner tries to take lot in his own hands and throw him out, at least he must be able to come to the court to seek the relief of protect the possession, not a positive relief. That is, he cannot file a suit for a declaration that he has a right to be in possession. No, that is not permissible. That's what he cannot say, I have perfected my title under section 53A, a statutory possession, and owner cannot touch me. No. But with the section saying owner is stopped and he can continue to in possession, his possession must be protected. Though section 53 is not a positive right available to the purchaser, certainly when a statutory bar is created on the transferor, though it does not confer any active title or right to the transferee, the possession of the transferee requires to be protected. Therefore, it is settled law that the doctrine envisaged in section 53A is available to a defendant to protect his possession and does not create title in the defendant. Because the only right conferred in the section 53A on the transferee in possession is the right to plead the estoppel against the transferor or persons claiming in the deed. This is the settled legal position. But in our country, we have wonderful laws, but most of the time, these laws are abused, misused, and therefore, legislature has no option except to intervene in the matter. Now, after 1990, when the country opened up, liberalization was the policy of the government. Especially, there was a shortage of housing in the country. We had rent control acts in all states, which virtually ruined the housing activity in the country. So because of the liberalization, sometimes privatization, and the Indian economy was open, encouragement was given to infrastructure project and housing projects. That is somewhere in 1993-94. Then the builders and developers in the country took advantage of this particular provision, that is 53A. What is it they did? They entered into joint development agreements. They obtained a power of attorney from the owners, constructed buildings, started selling the properties, enjoying the property being in possession. See the provision in the Income Tax Act. Now under the Income Tax Act, to liability of payment of capital gains is not dependent on the registration of a sale. If possession is delivered under the contract of sale, the liability to payment of capital gains arises. But in this case, as I pointed out to you, the section 53A, as stood earlier, specifically said the, what you call, specifically said that the contract, though required to be registered, has not been registered. The protection was given under section 53A. So it resulted people enter into agreements without registration. We call it a joint development agreement, agreement of sale, whatever it is. Then the entire construction activity went on, thus denying to the government what is legitimately due to them in the form of stamp duty and registration charges. So nearly after 20-25 years, the governments of the day opened their eyes. Then what happened was, as it involved huge loss of revenue to the governments, in the conference of the chief ministers and finance ministers of states and union territories, convened by the union finance minister held on 14th September 1998 at New Delhi, they arrived at a consensus to amend the aforesaid laws to plug the loss of revenue to the government. Accordingly, the Parliament enacted Amendment Act, Registration and Other Related Laws, Amendment Act of 2001, Act Number 48 of 2001. So, by this amended act, in one stretch, the Parliament amended the Registration Act of 1908, Transfer of Property Act of 1882, and also the Indian Stamp Act of 1899. So, by the word, by this amendment to Section 53A, the words, the contract, though registered, required to be registered, has not been registered, was omitted. Expressly when the section said, if it do not register, now that word is removed. And therefore, because of the omission of that, today it has become necessary or compulsory to register an agreement of sale, provided you want the benefit of Section 53. Because this amendment became necessary because they amended Section 17 of the Registration Act. Section 17 of the Registration Act deals with documents which are compulsorily registrable. That is 17.1. Now, agreement of sale is not a compulsory registrable document, optional. Now, therefore, by this amendment, they introduce what is called as 1A, subsection 1A. The subsection 1A says, the documents containing contract to transfer for consideration any immovable property for the purpose of Section 53A of the Transfer of Property Act shall be registered if they have been executed on or after the commencement of the Registration and Other Related Laws Amendment Act. And if such documents are not registered on or after such commencement, then they shall have no effect for the purpose of the said Section 53. So this makes all the difference. Though the earlier law was a contract of sale to which Section 53A was attracted, need not be registered. Now, law is amended, both Registration Act and Transfer of Property Act, to say registration is compulsory. Only if contract of sale where possession is delivered is registered, then the benefit of 53A, that is, estoppel against the transfer of protection of protecting possession of the property which was delivered is available. But if it is not registered, agreement is not inadmissible, agreement is not void, it could be treated as an ordinary agreement of sale as defined in the contract, Section 54, that no interest in the immovable property is transferred and his only right is to file a suit for possession. The question of protecting possession does not arise. This possession given under the contract of sale has to be completely ignored. This amendment came into effect from 2001. So therefore, it is only the registered contract for sale in respect of immovable property shall be recognized for the purpose of Section 53A. Now, consequently, Section 49 of the Registration Act was also amended in addition to introducing 17.1A. Section 49 speaks about effect of non-registration of documents required to be registered. It says no document required by Section 17 of the Transfer of Property Act to be registered, A, shall affect any immovable property comprised therein. Then C said, be received as evidence of any transaction affecting such property or conferring such power unless it has been registered. This is the law. It is inadmissible. There is a proviso. It said, provided that an unregistered document affecting immovable property and required by this act or the Transfer of Property Act to be registered may be received. This is where the lawyers come in. May be received as evidence of a contract in a suit for specific performance under Chapter 2 of the Specific Act. That is, there is a sale deed. sale deed is not registered. It can't be looked into as a sale. But this proviso said that can be looked into as a contract of sale. You can't look into it as a sale deed because it is not registered. But that document will be looked into as a agreement of sale. And then, or as evidence of part performance of a contract for the purpose of 53A of the transfer contract, this was omitted. So therefore, law correspondingly omitted this provision from section 49. And then B says, as evidence of any collateral transaction, not required to be affected. So what is collateral transaction is well understood. Even though the document is not registered, as in the case of stamp duty, it is not a case of inadmissible document. It could be admitted for collateral purposes, but for the main object, that document cannot be admitted. Section 17(1)(a) itself made it very clear. If the document is not registered, then you cannot invoke 53A, but it could be looked into as a contract for sale. So therefore, law has undergone change with the changing times. That is because of the importance of this particular problem. Though the document was not registered, it was a mere contract of sale. Though section 54 said no right or interest passes under the contract, 53A gave a statutory right. More than the contract of sale, less than the sale deed under 54. Because when a statute gives a right, to enforce the statutory right, certainly the courts are bound to respect it and protect the possession of the transferee in possession. So therefore, today we come across cases where agreements of sale are there, possession is delivered. If possession is delivered under a contract of sale, Stamp Act is also accordingly amended, and the stamp duty payable on such agreement of sale is that of conveyance. Today in law, they make no difference between 54 and 53A. To attract 54, the document should be registered. To attract 53A, document should be registered. If 53A document is registered, though title doesn't pass, possession is protected. In 54, you have possession and title. That's the only difference. This all happened because of the huge growth in the construction activity in the country, especially providing houses to the needy persons throughout the country. And there, one of the main sources of income for any government is the revenue from the stamp duty and registration charges. So when people took advantage of this provision and tried to avoid payment of duty, the parliament, having seen how things are moving, amended all these three laws to make it clear that without registration of an agreement of sale, this benefit of section 53A is not available to the purchaser. Now, two other questions would pop up in the background of this. We have a series of laws which says, though you have an agreement of sale, if you are ready and willing to perform your part of the contract, in the normal circumstances, you should go to court and obtain a sale deed. If for any reason you are not being able to get the sale deed, if possession is not taken, suit will be dismissed on the ground of limitation. Specific performance then being a discretionary remedy cannot be granted in favor of a person who has not come to court in time or who has come to court after time. The remedy is lost, though right is not lost. Now, in the case where possession is given, but he doesn't file a suit for specific performance, what is the position? So it has been clearly held, even if a suit for specific performance is bought by time, he is not trying to enforce the contract. If he has been put in possession in part performing the contract of sale, and he is ready and willing to perform his part of the contract, though he may not get title, the owner, the transferor, cannot dispossess the purchaser. That's the settled law. Now, conversely, if a suit for specific performance is filed by a person who got possession in an agreement of sale, and specific performance suit is dismissed, then what is the condition? He is in possession. There is a valid agreement of sale. Now, the decisions are held. On what ground a suit for specific performance will be dismissed? It will be dismissed on the ground that he was not ready and willing to perform his part of the contract. And the suit is in bank. If he is not ready and willing to perform his part of the contract, then Section 53A is also not applied. So question of his protecting possession on the basis of 53A will not arise, because there is already a finding with the court that you are not ready and willing. Mere existence of a contract in writing for a consideration and handing over possession under the contract would not give you the right under 53A. In addition to that, the purchaser must be always ready and willing to perform a part of the contract. If he is not ready and willing to perform, then 53A is not applied. If in a suit filed for specific performance, his claim is dismissed on the ground that he was not ready and willing to perform a part of the contract, then in a suit filed for recovery of possession by the owner, he cannot again plead 53A. 53A is not available to him, because one of the main ingredients of 53A, that readiness, willingness to perform is part of the obligation, is held to be not there, and 53A has no application to such contract. Therefore, as I said, one area where still the law is not well settled or clear is this. If a person is put in possession in part performance of the contract of sale, and he is ready and willing to perform his part of the contract, and knowing the estoppel operating against him under Section 53A by the owner of the property, he will not go to court, because 53A will be set up in the defense. When he tries to take possession by force, is it not open to the agreement holder to go to court in advance and complain of his forcible disposition and make it clear to the court that his possession is protected under the statute, and you please see that I am not dispossessed? So it is not a case of going to the court to enforce a positive right. It is not a case of going to the court for any declaration of right. But it is a defensive relief. When you say it can't be used as a sword but only a shield, fine, that is understandable. You cannot attack him. It is not a case of attacking. Even you are going to court to protect yourself. You are not seeking for any relief, no declaration, no right. But you say, the statute has given me this right. The other person has no respect for the law. He is trying to deny me the statutory right. Therefore, you come to my rescue and protect my statutory right. Please defend my possession. Please protect my possession. In my view, such a relief sought in the court would not be in the nature of a sword, but it would be in the nature of a shield to protect a lawful possession under a statutory provision. And when now the law has specifically said to register the document, you are assured of this protection. Probably in the days to come, we should see how the judges take the view, and in a given case, but in one of the Bombay cases, they upheld this contention that they said the court cannot be a silent spectator. When the statute gives him the protection, when another person has no respect for the law, when he takes law, when the court goes to his rescue, it is not a question of wielding the sword. It is a question of shielding the person from this aggression. And that is the purpose of Section 53A. So therefore, this 53A is a concept. As I said, we have inherited from the English law. It is an equitable doctrine. Even today, that law is in full force in English. And here it has become a statutory problem. When it was misused, Parliament has stepped in and brought in substantial amendments to protect its interests and also the interest of a bona fide purchaser. And now it is for the courts to interpret the law protect his position, respect the mandate of the parliament, and in the end of the day, though our courts are legal courts, certainly this equitable remedy, equitable relief, also could be granted to the courts, because this equitable doctrine of court performance is a part of a statutory law in our country. Even though you are enforcing a statutory provision, the principle contained in the statutory provision is nothing but an equitable relief of protecting the possession of a bona fide purchaser for valuable consideration, who has been put in possession of the property in part performance of the court. So I would be glad to have an interaction before I will stop it here.
Yes, sir. So we had Justice A.S. Bopanna also on the platform. And we will be, and so the question is by Radhesham Maurya. So kindly advise the collateral purpose in an unregistered documents. Kindly explain with an illustration.
Collateral purpose, the explanation given mostly for that word is this. Under the Indian law, a partition need not be in writing. In our state, we call it as palupatti. That is, if you divide the properties by meets and bounds and make a list of those properties, that itself is a proof of partition. The other way is to avoid registration and stamp duty. If you enter into a memorandum of partition, recording a past transaction, if under the memorandum you effect a partition, that is a partition deed. You are not effecting any partition under the partition deed. You are recording a partition which has taken place earlier. And that also does not require stamp duty and registration. That's what the Supreme Court has said. Oral partition. A palupatti, that is, list of properties distributed in a partition, by itself is a proof of partition, and a memorandum of partition recording a past transaction. In all these three cases, the document doesn't require registration. But the law says if the partition takes place under a written document, then it is compulsorily registered. If it is not registrable, it is inadmissible. You cannot take the benefit of that. Now the question is, it is inadmissible because of want of registration. But the question is, those documents are marked for collateral purposes. So what is a partition? What is a collateral purpose? A very good question. That document cannot be looked into to create a right. Because in a partition, everyone has an antecedent right, but he is not sure of what property belongs to him. What happens at a partition is, their shares are determined, the properties are bifurcated, and once the property is given partition to them, it exclusively belongs to them, and the other loses their right. And they continue, if they are in possession, they continue to be in possession. If they are not in possession, they should be given possession. All this is permissible if the document is a registered document. If the document is not registered, but all these ingredients are there, still it can be looked into by the courts for collateral purposes. So what is the collateral purposes for which a partition can be looked into? The collateral purpose for which the document can be looked into is in proof of a partition. That's all. The family is no more joined, the family is divided. Or if he is already in possession of the property and if he is able to show documents, say for example in agricultural land, mutation entries, record of rights, where his name is written in respect of a particular property, it could be looked into to show he is in possession. But that document is not a document of title. By looking into the document, you cannot declare him as the owner. So if he's in possession, to protect his possession, yes. That is the collateral purpose for which it can be. Whether the family continues to be joined or family is divided, that document can be looked into to know there is a partition. But what property is fell to his share, what is his right, that cannot be looked into and the court cannot get into it. So the collateral purpose, when we talk about this, collateral, that is other than the purpose of which the document is entered into. The partition is entered into to see that this is the property which has fallen to my share, this is the property fallen to my share, that is not for me. But the fact that there was a partition, the fact that his possession is lawful, that is the collateral purpose. One example.
Yes, sir. This is in the present scenario when the housing has seen a rapid growth. What's the purpose of keeping Rent Control Act?
Today, virtually the Rent Control Act have become redundant because the area of application has become very small. We compare to prior to 2000, especially in cities like Bangalore, Bombay, eviction petitions used to take 20 years and then the revision, then the Supreme Court. In the lifetime, the eviction orders were not passed. It had a devastating effect as far as construction activity is concerned. That is how those laws were amended. They were repealed. Now today, what you have is a Rent Act and not a Rent Control Act. No more control. And then that was confined to only small areas where normally people belonging to economically weaker section, they were given protection. Bigger buildings where the rent is more than a particular limit, the application of Rent Act was taken away. Then the Transfer of Property Act was made. That is why today, throughout the country, you find such an exponential growth in the housing industry. And today, virtually, you have to beg the tenants to come and occupy your place, whether it's commercial or non-commercial. Especially in cities like Bangalore, lakhs of square feet of commercial and thousands of apartments are vacant, unoccupied. Therefore, today, Rent Control Act has no place at all. Very, very limited jurisdiction. Very, very limited.
That's true. The window is very narrow in town.
Yes.
This is by Sudarshan Reddy. The purchaser satisfies the ingredient of Section 53A. He's entitled to protect his possession. That is shield. Owner is disentitled to recover possession.
Correct.
Then who is vested with the ownership's rights entitled as such?
The ownership continues with him, whereas possessory title continues with this person. He will never become a owner. He will never be, because he has been put into possession lawfully. He cannot claim adverse possession. He is in lawful possession. His possession is protected under 53A. His title won't be only possessory title. The real ownership continues with the real owner. But it is of no use. As long as he is not able to get possession, virtually he has lost the interest in the property. Whereas under Section 27 of the Limitation Act, once an adverse possession is pleaded and proved, if a person is away from the property for 12 long years, the title vests with the person in possession. The real owner loses the title. Such a thing will not happen in 53A. He will never become the owner. He can only protect his possession and call it as possessory title.
This is by Amit J. If sale deed is not executed and limitation to file specific performance suit is also not filed by the transferee in possession, can transferee further sell the property? How can then transferee perfect his title?
There is no question of title. Transferee can sell the property or transfer the property. What he transfers is what right he has got. He is not the owner. His right is under 53A. That right under 53A certainly he can convey. Neither he was the owner and the person who gets the property will never get ownership. He can never call himself as a title holder.
This is by OnePlus. Whether possession under Section 53A can be used as an adverse possession?
That's what I said. Nec qui, nec com, nec praetorio. All these three conditions will be there for adverse possession. That is, you must be in possession for more than 12 years. Your possession should be adverse and it should be with open hostility. when possession is given under 53A, there is no hostile intention. And therefore, unless there is a hostility, question of your perfecting, asserting your title will not arise. The title which you can assert is only possessory title. You can never say, I am the owner. Whereas in the case of adverse possession, he will say, I am the owner. At any rate, I have perfected my title by adverse possession after the expiry of 10 years. And I have been in possession openly and continuously with a hostile intention. All that is missing in 53A.
How an unregistered, this is where Asrina, how an unregistered agreement for sale can be used for a collateral purpose under section 53A, kindly explain with illustrations.
No, unregistered agreement of sale is admissible in evidence. There is no difficulty. Agreement of sale in Karnataka, it is 200 rupees stamp paper. If 200 rupees on stamp paper, if the agreement is written, it is admissible in evidence. Assuming that 200 rupees is not there, all the section 34 of the Stamp Act says is impound the document, collect duty and 10 times penalty, 200 plus 2,200, that agreement becomes admissible. But if possession is delivered under the agreement of sale, and the purchaser wants the statutory protection under section 53A, that document is not admissible, but it is admissible as an agreement of, that is precisely what section 17(1)(a) says. It is not a case of inadmissibility of the document. Please see the amendment carefully. It says, the documents containing contracts to transfer for consideration any immovable property for the purpose of section 53A of the Transfer Property Act shall be registered. That is a requirement. If they have been executed on or after the commencement of the registration and other related laws. So it requires compulsory registration. Now, if it is not registered, there is no collateral purpose. And if such documents are not registered, on or after such commencement, then they shall have no effect for the purposes of the section 53. It is admissible in evidence. On that basis, you can file a suit for specific performance. If you have made money, you can ask for recovery of that money also. But non-registration disentitles you to claim the statutory protection of possession. If you want to protect possession, document requires registration. If you are not registered, you are not entitled to protect your possession, but you can enforce the agreement, obtain a sale deed, then take possession.
B.S. Satyanathan, one of the conditions of section 53A is that purchaser has to be ready and willing to perform its part of contract. If the purchaser does not file a suit for specific performance to enforce the agreement, even after the expiry of limitation period, can the purchaser still file a suit for injunction to protect his possession? And what explanation can he give about his readiness and willingness?
That's precisely what I said. Readiness and willingness is assuming an agreement of sale. 40 lakhs is the sale consideration. The only obligation cast on the purchaser is that he should pay 40 lakhs within a particular time. On the date of agreement, he pays 20 lakhs. Possession is given to him. Within another 6 months, he has to pay 20 lakhs. He pays it. And all that remains to be done is, he should pay the stamp duty and take the sale deed. So, virtually, he has performed his part of the contract. Nothing more remains to be done. So, in such a scenario, he doesn't file a suit for specific performance. Say, it is bought by time. Even if it is bought by time, he has not filed a suit for specific performance. The law says the owner is stopped from recovering possession. It is the owner who loses the right when the other obligations cast on the purchaser is fulfilled.
So he has fulfilled all the obligations of the contract. So therefore, the question of his ready and willingness will not arise. He not only was not ready and willing, he has performed his part of the contract. In which event, according to me, if there is an attempt to dispossess, and even if the time for specific performance is bought, his possession should be protected. And that limited right of protecting possession could be by approaching the court by way of a preventive relief, not a positive relief, a preventive relief. Preventive relief of protecting possession, which is in nothing but a sheen. The order to be given by the court is in the form of a sheen, and it is not a sword.
This is by Chetas Govda. Unregistered agreement, some amount paid in the said agreement. After a lapse of 5 years, can a claim for recovery of the said money be made?
That depends upon the terms of the contract. Question is, what is the time prescribed for performing the contract? Now, Article 54 of the Limitation Act says, if a particular time is fixed for performance, suit is to be filed within 3 years therefrom. If no time is fixed, it is from the date of the agreement of sale. So this limitation depends upon the terms of the contract. If he has paid money and there was still time to perform, and for some reason it is not performed, the suit filed within 3 years from the date prescribed is well within time. Even though it is 5 years, suppose that time is prescribed for 1 year, 2 years, it is permissible.
This is by Vikas Steele. In 1988, GPA and will were registered and one affidavit qua full and final payment was received, was also executed. But there was no agreement to sell. Now the seller cancelled the GPA and will. What are the remedies available to both of them?
53A is not right. But still, under a will he got the property. And the will is proved. And power of attorney is given. If it is a what is called as power of attorney coupled with interest, then he could claim his right under that, either as a person with the power of attorney coupled with interest, or if under a will is getting the property by proving the will. 53A is not attractive because there is no written contract, there is no contract in writing for constitution. Then 53A is out.
This is by B.S. Satyan. Continuing with the earlier question, let's assume that he has not paid the entire amount. No suit for specific performance if filed also within time. Then can he deposit the balance amount in the suit for injunction to show his readiness and willingness to purchase the money of which he was in possession?
Readiness and willingness is to be shown from the date of the agreement till the date of the register sale. After delivery of possession, if a time is fixed for payment of the balance consideration, he should have paid it then. If the balance sale consideration is to be paid at the time of registration, at least he must have said, before that time, I am ready with the sale consideration. Please come and execute the sale deed and take the money. Having made that offer and shown that the money is in the bank, because he did not come forward, he also did not file the suit, then he has complied with the requirement of 53A. Then even after the expiry of the period, probably he could go to court for an injunction. But he's depositing the money after the period prescribed at the time of the filing of the suit by itself will not show his readiness and willingness. He should be ready and willing to perform his part of the contract from the date of sale till the date of this LD. So during that interregnum period, if he has not made an offer to pay the money, if he does not show that he was ready with the consideration, again 53A is not required. His depositing the money after the expiry of 53A will not bring the case within 53A.
This is by Angad Kamath. He says, the concept of readiness and willingness has been deleted under the amendment of 2018 to the specific relief act. How will that affect the proceedings under section 53A?
Sorry, it is not deleted. What is deleted is the earlier section 20, which made it a discretionary relief. Now under section 60, what they have done is, the plaintiff should plead and prove for the word. Now the word plead is deleted. You understand, we had a wonderful discussion. There should be a plea. that I'm ready and willing to perform, then there should be proof of readiness and willingness. And in the appendix to the Civil Procedure Code, there is a standard plaint copy. So one of the earlier Supreme Court judgments said, if in the plaint you have not said I'm ready and willing to perform, then the suit was dismissed. But subsequently, that law was diluted by saying, though the word ready and willing net not there, but if the other averments can give rise to that, that is sufficient. Now in the section, what they have removed is only the word plead. The word prove continues. Today, pleading is not required, but proof is a must. Even if you have not pleaded, unless you prove your readiness and willingness, you are not entitled to the duty. That word pleading, plead and prove in section 16.1 is what is deleted.
This is on the Facebook by Peter Jay Prakash. Patna land is registered as per the settlement deed, but a relative enjoys the same land. What is the remedy to take back in possession?
Please repeat it.
Sir, Patna land is registered as per the settlement deed, but a relative enjoys the same land. What is the remedy to take back the possession?
See, in the absence of a tenancy in respect to that, the person in possession, we do not know in what right he is claiming. If he is not set up a plea of tenancy, if you are the owner of the property, you can always file a suit for recovery of possession based on your title. Now, in some places, this patta book itself is treated as a document of title. If it is based on a grant, you will not find a registered document. So, suit for recovery of possession based on title. Unless he sets up a plea of tenancy, which is protected under the tenancy law. Otherwise, he is entitled to possession.
This is by Amar Kumar Sahu. In a sale deed, the Wendy's paid a part payment, and for balance payment, he issued post-dated checks and got the sale deed registered and also recorded, and also the record of right before the encashment of PDC, and further sold the property to another person. In this case, whether the rights of a subsequent purchaser would be affected or not?
It won't be affected. As the definition of sale makes it very clear. The sale could be for a part of the consideration of. You see the definition of sale. That's why I said very important to know the definition of the word sale as defined under 54. A sale is a transfer of ownership in exchange for a price paid. That is, whatever is the consideration, you have to pay. Or promised. If you have promised something also, sale is complete. Or part paid and part promised. So even if by paying a part payment, if they have completed the transaction, it is there. But again, it depends on the terms of the sale deed. If the term of the sale deed is, this is the consideration, I have received this amount, the balance amount is payable, say within 6 months. On the payment of the balance amount, the title is complete. If it is returned, and if the balance payment is not paid, he will not become the absolute owner. But if that word is missing, and only said, I have received so much, and he has agreed to pay the balance in 6 months, and sale deed is executed, if he does not pay the balance consideration, his remedy is to recover the money and say there is no title. And if that property is sold to some other person, he gets title. And that person can only proceed against this person and that person for recovery of the balance sale consideration, but the title is complete, title is not missing. Mm-hmm.
For an unregistered lease deed of 99 years, can the landlord go to the court for eviction? Where payment is paid and lessee is using it.
That's correct. Lease is for 99 years. It is unregistered. Once it is unregistered, it ceases to be a 99 years lease. If he is put in possession and he is paying the money, rent, and if the lease is for not a manufacturing process, the law is very clear. It is a monthly tenancy. issue legal notice or 15 days notice and file a suit for eviction. The mere fact that period agreed upon is 99 years will not come to the rescue because court cannot look into the lease deed, is yet visible. The only collateral purpose which the lease deed can be looked into is what is this, in what capacity is in possession. He is in possession as a tenant. And terminate the tenancy, file a suit, and tenant will not be entitled to the benefit of 99 years lease because that document is not registered.
This is by Patel. Possession delivered on an unregistered and unstamped document. In a suit for injunction, ex parte or temporary injunctions, can it be granted or not?
At the stage of ex parte, prima facie case, we talk about prima facie case. The power of the court to impound a document which is insufficiently stamped will arise only when the document is tendered in evidence. When you are filing a suit, you produce a document. When you are arguing a matter for injunction, you are the court to look into the terms, not going to the question of registration and limitation. So therefore, at that stage, it can be looked into. And at that stage, relief can be granted. Even otherwise, I said, collateral purpose. If he is able to show I am an agreement holder, I am in possession, protect my possession, the court will do it.
This is on Facebook, Harpriya. So what is the effect if total sale consideration is paid and the agreement of sale is validated?
Invalidated.
Is written is validated.
No, that's what I said. You please see the contract for sale definition. That's precisely we have to keep in mind. A contract for the sale of immovable property is a contract that a sale of such property shall take place on terms settled between the parties. It does not of itself create any interest in or charge on such property. So a contract is entered into, consideration is agreed upon, the entire consideration is paid at a lump sum, but that does not create any interest in immovable property. No charge on the property is created also under Section 100. His only right is to file a suit for specific performance and get possession.
So we will be taking last two questions. Amar Kumar Sahu, this is again on Facebook. In a sale deed, the vendee paid part payment and for balance payment, This is by Kumar Madhukar. Lordship, the unregistered agreement was done for an ancestral property, advance given to a widowed mother on the condition that she will convince her children, but out of five children, four go to the court for partition of that property. Does Section 53A or specific performance of contract applies in such circumstances or not?
53A binds only the person who has signed the document. If there are five co-owners and one co-owner enters into an agreement, maybe he is in possession, puts him in possession. 53A cannot be pressed into service against other co-owners, co-sharers who are not parties to the agreement. Because in law, the possession of one sharer is the possession of everybody. No doubt he has been given possession, but that is not a possession to be protected under 53A because four owners have not executed the agreement of sale in his favor.
Yes. Yes, I don't think we have any question. Last question. I was thinking that we will wind up, but the way you are elucidating with so much clarity, people are just asking the questions. This is by SS Kabur. In a suit filed by sisters based upon the 2005 Amendment Act, partition deed was not registered, but after partition, sale transaction was taken place between the shares. It means one sharer sold some of his share to another shareholder under sale deed and are in possession accordingly. Is it a valid partition and can that unregistered deed looked into by the court as there is a partition as collateral or a main document?
Subsection 5 of the amended Section 6 makes it emphatically clear. Partition for the purpose of this section means a partition in writing registered under the provision of the Registration Act. So language employed is very clear. If there is no partition before 20th December 2004, the daughter who has been conferred the status of a co-partner would be entitled to a share in the property. However, subsection 2 of section 6 categorically states, if there is any disposition by way of sale, partition, unregistered on or before 20th of December 2004, the daughter who is conferred a co-partition right will not get right in that form. So therefore, there was no written partition. Maybe it's a oral partition. In that partition, one person got a property to his share. If it's an agricultural land, probably there will be a mutation entry. On that basis, he has sold the property to a third person by a registered document. So therefore, that document, which is registered prior to this 20th December 2004, takes away the right of the daughter. Now, recent judgment of the Supreme Court, to some extent, clarified the position. Though the section says it should be a partition deed registered under the Partition Act, they have said in some cases, there may be a partition. Partition is acted upon. Correspondingly, mutation entries have been made. And then parties have acted on that basis. If there is proof, evidence by, not a partition deed, by public documents, then in that case, in its discretion, the court may uphold that partition. That is a slight, departure which has been made in the latest Supreme Court judge as against the subsection 5, which categorically states partition means partition by a, in writing, registered under the Provisional Registration Act. So any alienations made prior to 20th, third party interest is protected, the daughter gets no right. Yes. There the question of oral partition, partition not being registered will not arise because it has gone to third parties.
So the last question, an unregistered agreement for sale is entered into and possession is taken into, is given to the transferee. To what extent such an unregistered agreement for sale can be used for collateral purpose?
For enforcement of the contract, section is very clear. You cannot use an unregistered agreement of sale for 53A. For all other purposes, it can be used. 53A benefit is not given. Question of protecting your possession will not arise. That equitable doctrine, part performance, protecting possession, estoppel against the owner, that is not there. Otherwise, an agreement of sale. And an agreement of sale, depending on the stipulation, whatever rights which is conferred to you under the agreement, you can enforce it. Agreement for you, performance, recovery of money, whatever it is.
So, as we had heard about you, we actually found that it was, as they say, larger than the life image. The way you have elucidatedly given the illustrations, the clarity of thoughts, clarity of legal position. And I'm receiving messages not only on the WhatsApp Plus as well as on this group and the Facebook that they have actually got enriched. And we are all enamored by the fact that the way you have expressed a very complicated subject as such, but in a very elucidated manner. And in our pursuit for having webinars, tomorrow we will be having a webinar on first appeal in civil cases and appreciation of evidence, oral and documentary evidence by Justice A. Hariprasad, a sitting judge of Kerala High Court, tomorrow at 5 p.m. We have shared the WhatsApp number in case you want to connect for the link. And those who want to see all those webinars which have been conducted by Beyond Law CLC, they can share, subscribe, and like to that of Beyond Law CLC. They can connect with that. And so thank you. And everyone, those who have been connected with us on the Facebook and on this platform, stay safe and stay blessed. And before parting, I would like to share that they say once this line is straight in an ECG, it gives a threatening call. But once in a webinar or on the Facebook, the number of participants remain constant. It gives a more sense of pride. And that is in the present case that the number of participants, not only on the Facebook, but also on the webinar itself, remains constant. And that gives us that, what I'm saying, only buttresses my submission to the fact that all the participants actually thoroughly enjoyed the insights given by you. Thank you, sir, once again, and stay safe, stay blessed. Namaskar.
Thank you. Namaskar.